स्वामी भक्ति निष्काम सन एंड ही हैज डन हिज पीजी मैकेनिकल फ्रॉम उत्कल यूनिवर्सिटी. ही हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन एमटेक इन फ्लूइड एंड थर्मल फ्रॉम आईआईटी गुवाहाटी एंड ही हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज डॉक्टरेट इन कोस्टल हाइड्रोडायनामिक्स अगेन फ्रॉम आईआईटी खड़गपुर. ही हैज वर्क एक्सपीरियंस एज वर्क एज विजिटिंग साइंस इन कोरिया under some ocean research and development center. The first person and he will be speaking of sorry Darwin, chemistry never made the transition to biology. That is the first topic. Then we have second guest with us, B.B. Muni. He has completed his engineering graduation in chemical from Osmania University. He has completed his post graduation from IIT Kanpur. And he has completed his doctorate again from IIT Kharagpur. He has some work experience in DRDO as well as he has worked as a professor in MIT Pune. He will be talking of information, knowledge and life in 21st century. Both of them, they are working under the guidance of Sripad Bhakti Madhavapuri. He has done his PhD from New Jersey and under quantum chemistry. Major quantum chemistry. This Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Bhatt, the guru is representing Guru Srila Bhakti Nirmal Acharya. So I request all of you to listen all these three fellows. They will be yes, and the third person. Mr. Sripad Kantha Krishna Prabhu from Venezuela, South America. He is practicing science of Bhakti Yoga since last 40 years and he is the senior most member of the team, AC Bhakti Vedanta Prabhu. Disciple of AC Bhakti Vedanta Prabhu.
I'd like to thank the Professor Ji for Nigam.
Yeah.
Professor Nigam Ji for kind introduction for our humble self, and also Principal Ji of this institute that he kindly arranged this program to interact with you all. So myself was doing my PhD in IIT Kharagpur and I came across one unique conference that is about aging and dying. IIT Kharagpur organized one conference, Aging and Dying. We are all going towards old age, we are all going towards death. So the IIT wanted to discuss that what you will do to the person who is on the verge of death. Suppose a man was a minister, was a doctor, was an engineer, very useful to the society, worked so much. But now he is old, lying on the bed, and only a burden to the society. So according to biology, he is nothing but a chemical. So will you give an injection to him so that he can happily die? Or you have to think about life more seriously. What is life? What is real nature? So that conference discussed that. Many scholars came from various backgrounds. And my spiritual master, Srila Bhaktisarva Damodar Maharaj, I first time met him there in that conference. He came and he explained scientifically what is life. It was a keynote address. And I'm surprised because all of my educational career, I never came across the subject which explains about myself. You have mechanical engineering, you have chemical engineering, you have arts, you have philosophy, so many things. But nothing of that talks about yourself. It's quite surprising. And science is coming from scientists. Charles Law, Boyle's Law, Newton's Law, Einstein's Law, so many laws are there, they are not coming from sky. They are coming from a living person. Science cannot exist without scientists. But amazingly, science misses the scientist. Science without the knowledge of the scientist is incomplete science. So from that lecture, I got inspired that I must make of, you know, this type of studies, you know, one of the main part of my life. I must study about life more seriously and try to help others understand what it is. Because we are all living beings. Are we electron, are we proton, are we air, are we fire, are we sky, what we are? We have to study it scientifically. Of course, this is the duty of the scientist. So, we have a website, you all can note down, scienceandscientist.org/Darwin. So in that website, we are publishing the articles of, you know, different recent developments. And you can read it, you can subscribe, there is a newsletter in that, there is a subscription box with your email. And many IIT professors, AIIMS doctors, they are part of that. And we have also a group. Can you go to the next slide, please? Yes. So before going into detail, I would like to offer my humble prayers to my divine masters. Om Adhyanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Salakaya Chakshu Nibinitam Nena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Sarutamadara Swami Kinamini Namo Sadhubhaktamane Manipuri Tvavecha Prabhupada Vashyadavani Pichare Nirtayati Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sivasati Shigora Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare. So my Guru Maharaj, Sri Damodar Maharaj, he did his PhD from University of California, and he was a chemical engineer, and he gave that lecture which inspired me. In 2006 he took Samadhi and asked me to work under his scientist godbrother, Shri Bhakti Madhav Puri Maharaj. He is a quantum chemist and well-known scientist from New Jersey, and he kindly guided us to Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math. My Brahmin Diksha Gurudev Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Govinda Goswami Maharaj and Sanyas Guru Srila Bhakti Nirmal Acharya Maharaj. So our organization is Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math. Next. So today I am going to speak about, sorry Darwin, chemistry never made the transition to biology. You can download this whole article, scienceandscientist.org/biology. And here I have referred more than 145 peer-reviewed journal articles. You know what, you should have a library, good library, yes, where we have journals also. You know, if you go for higher studies, masters, in good institutes and PhD, you have to publish articles. You do your works and you have to send it to a good journals according to your works. You know, you have to send it to good journals. And there are some reviewers in that field and they will review your article and they found it suitable and they publish the article in their journal. And some of the published, you know, good journal articles came into the textbooks which your professors are teaching you, right? Your professor don't doubt the text in the textbook. He simply reads it and, you know, teaches you. You ask him whether you did experiments, all these things. Well, no, I just read the textbook, right? But he has faith on those scientists. So journals, they have standard and, you know, they follow the journals, you know, the textbooks. Next. So, before going into detail, I would like to ask you a question among you, if you can tell me, what is the difference between biology, chemistry and physics? What is the difference between biological system, chemical system and a mechanical system? Can anybody raise their hand who can explain? Yes, please. Anybody? What is the difference between biological system, chemical system and mechanical system? Any difference, do you think? There is some difference? Yes, what is the difference? Please try, make an attempt. Don't be afraid, I am not reducing your grades. Yes? Who wants to make an attempt? Answer the question. Do you understand my question? Yes? You want to say something? What is the difference between chemical system, mechanical system? Biology is the study of human? Acha. Any other? Thank you. Any other explanation somebody wants to give? You see, very simple. You know, there are two photographs you can see. One is of NaCl, another is of living cell, right? So, you can see next slide, can go to next slide. there is a robot. It's a mechanical system, right? So, what is the difference between these three systems if you imagine NaCl, sodium chloride, how they are connected together? Sodium and chloride, what connects them? There is some chemical bond, right? Which connects those two elements, right? Sodium and chloride. And it becomes sodium and chloride, sodium chloride combined. It's a salt, right? And when you talk about this robot, there are some different parts. How they are connected together, what connects them? How a bicycle, different parts are connected? Nuts and bolts, some external force, right? You can separate all those parts, right? And again you can assemble them, possible, right? In chemical reactions you can do so, right? You cannot do? You can separate and you can again combine, right? And what about the body, your hand, your leg? Biology not only for human being, it is for all the living species, not only for human being. So, take example of any cell, one bacteria cell you can take, in your body one cell you can take, any living cell, there are many parts in that, there are membrane, there is DNA, there is RNA, there is amino acids, different things are there. You can separate all of them. Can you again combine them and make a living cell? Your eye, your leg, your head, everything is separated out. And again combine, make it. Possible? Not possible? What connects all these parts in a body? What is connecting element? In case of chemical system, there is chemical bond. In a mechanical system, there is some external force. In a biological system, how your whole body is connected, what connects it?
Muscles.
Muscles. A man is, senseless, and his muscles are there, but still he is not connected, right? Hands are moving, exactly. What connects the whole body? What connects? Yes, one person who wants to speak. Don't be afraid, speak, stand and speak, no problem. Yes. You want to say something? Just stand up. Skeleton. The skeleton is there. A body, a man is senseless, skeleton is there. But still, it is not connected. What connects? Cells. Cells are there. Nervous system. Still, nervous system is there. Yes, one person. Don't talk among each other. One person. Who wants to say? Yes, what?
All cells together bonding.
You know about something called consciousness?
Yes.
You heard about it? There is a journal of consciousness. Now biology, they tell about sentience. In biology, they use the word sentience. S-E-N-T-I-E-N-C-E. Sentience. Consciousness. Now, recent biology, they are using the term sentience. So, consciousness is the connecting link for different elements in the living system. And non-living system, there are some chemical bonds and there are some external forces. This is the major distinction which biologists could not understand for the last 150 years. Only recent time, they are acknowledging this in the population. Quite surprising. For last 150 years, they following the Darwin, they only told that life is coming from chemicals. Life is coming from chemicals. They could not distinguish between chemistry, physics and biology. They wanted to reduce the department of biology to a combination of physics and chemistry. You see, there is organic chemistry department, right? So they wanted to reduce the biology department to also a chemistry department. They tried hard. And at last, they come to an amazing conclusion. Today, I am going to discuss it briefly. Next. You see, in past, people were thinking that life can come from non-life. And, there is a rotten meat from where, some insects forms in the meat. And they were thinking that rotten meat is the source of life. Amazing. You can go through origin of life theory studies. Scientists were thinking rotten meat is the source of origin of life. And one great scientist, he did some experiments And even, you know, you see all these people, Newton, Harvey, Descartes, all big people, they were being that idea. They were believing that from rotten meat, life can come. Quite surprising. For a long, long time. When the scientist Francisco Reed did the experiments with the three flasks, he kept the meat in three flasks, and one flask he kept it open to the air, and second he covered it with the cloth, and third one he airtight sealed it. Okay? After a few days, he found there is, and there are insects in that meat, in which one is open to the air. Next one, there are insects in the top of the cloth, but third one there were no insects. And from this, he proved that there are some flies which are coming and laying egg on the meat, and from there the insects are coming. So life can only come from life. Life can only come from life. And later on, Louis Pasteur, he did a famous experiment, that swan neck flask experiment, and he proved, there is a proved theory called theory of biogenesis. Theory of biogenesis in biology, which explains life can only come from life. And we are all proof of that, isn't it? From where we are all coming? Is there anybody who say that my parents are oxygen or hydrogen? Can anybody say? Nobody can say. Even an amoeba or a bacteria, you cannot say this bacteria can parents are in hydrogen or oxygen. No. Impossible. One bacteria has another bacteria, you know, to produce. Impossible to produce without the parent. Whatever it may be, how much big scientist may be, you have to take material from parents. Otherwise it cannot do so. So life can only produce life. This is the proven theory in biology. Next. So soon after that, you know, scientists proposed a theory following the Darwin, that is told that somehow and other some raw materials which are important for the formation of the cell, they come together in a warm little pond and first living cell form, which is known as spontaneous generation of life. So this theory, because Darwin was proposing the evolution theory, right? From amoeba, you know, comes the multicellular organisms, from that fish and then frog and then, you know, all these reptiles and of the human being, the progression, there's a tree of life that Darwin proposed. So he was proposing, so when he was being asked the question about what about first life, then he said that the first life came from a warm little pond. Famous idea of Darwin, that warm little pond produced the life, first life. So his idea was famous and people started, you know, collecting evidence how to prove that idea. Right? But is it not a intelligent, you know, question? Every day you are seeing sun is rising in the which direction? Yes. If some big bank comes and say, no, first sunrise was in the west, you will not ask for the proof? You will ask or not? Or you will accept, oh, he's a big man, I should accept him. There are scientists who maintain the challenge that no, if life is always coming from life, there must be first life. If life is always coming from life, there must be first life. This idea of imposing that non-life give rise to life is incorrect. And it continued, that challenge continued, and people started working on that direction also. But they were not getting much support until recent time. So, the later on, next, the Darwin's idea got some, you know, support. But in recent time, there is an idea called primordial bombardments. Primordial bombardments, you heard this term or not, I don't know. But what happened, you know, Darwin proposed millions of years back, life being created. And the time which Darwin was suggesting, creation of first life, now the space scientists, they found out this term, that our Earth was experiencing very harsh environment. Our Earth was experiencing very harsh environment, and from outer space, big particles were coming and they're colliding. Big, you know, planets and meteoroids, they were coming and colliding with our Earth planet. And lot of heat was generated, and that heat will not allow any life to survive. If that is the case, then such a life has to create many, many times. It's not the first time that this life is created. Such life has to create many, many times, which makes it impossible. Because Darwin told, if such event have occurred, only once it has occurred. But this primordial bombardment is a challenge to such idea, because it states that such a life has to create many, many times. Because again and again, that in a big particles were coming and collide, right? So the Darwin's idea being challenged from this theory, and in 125th birthday of Science magazine, Science and Nature, they are the top journals of the scientific world. And you can find, you can type in Google, what don't we know? And you find the 125th anniversary issue of Science magazine. And the title is What Don't We Know? What Science Don't Know, basically. And many questions it listed on that. But how and where did life arise? Is the question of our end, which present discussion. And also, what kinds of consciousness, what is dream, so many other questions, how much you can extend human form of life by medical research, all these questions that Science magazine listed in that. So very interesting. For our interest is this, that the question is how and where did life arise from that? And one scientist in 1990, he himself told, you see, read this sentence, what he had written in the published journal in Science. Sorry Charles, your warm little pond was a beautiful image. It's been enshrined in innumerable textbooks as the scientific theory of origin of life. But to hear the planetary scientists talking these days, you were dead wrong. The warm little pond never existed. This is the statement of the one of the top scientists in the published literature in Science magazine. So scientists started challenging the idea of Darwin in the top journals. And the movement started growing in that direction. So, next slide. So there are many, what you can say, obstacles that chemical evolution must surpass. Next. You see, first thing is that, you know about thermodynamics? You studied about thermodynamics? Yes? Thermodynamics, entropy, law of entropy you studied? You don't know about entropy? It's a standard concept. Entropy, never studied? Never. Okay. Entropy is the measure of disorderness. Like in this room, if you leave this room, it's now you nicely arrange everything, and you leave this room without maintaining. Will it room be maintained in order? You maintain this room at temperature of say 10 degree and leave this. Will it be maintained in 10 degree centigrade? What will happen? It will again go to the room temperature, isn't it? So the disorderness is increasing. You cannot maintain an order. You understand? You need some maintaining principle to have an order, right? So the question is, a body is there, right? You have a body. So this body is very orderly. A man dies. What happens to the body? Decomposes. It becomes simplified, right? It never becomes complex. You never find air, fire, different elements, chemicals coming together. Nice fish body, frog body is forming. Why? Because it is against the law of entropy. It will not occur. Polymers never form without the help of life. Polymers never form. You understand? Polymer science is a big, complicated, science. We have to do so many of planned reactions to have a polymer. You understand? So without the help of life, this complex existence of life will not come into existence. You understand? You accept that you are all bodies. How many of you accept that you are all bodies? Raise your hand if you accept I am the body. Please. Yes? One man. Any other? Yes? He raises hand. You are the body, right? You raise your hand. Any other? Nobody believes that you are body? Yes, please raise your hand. You are body or not? Please, you don't believe that you are body? No or yes? Okay, only one man believes. What makes you believe that you are the body? Please tell me. Yes? What?
Senses.
You have senses. But are you body? Yes? Okay. Every day what you eat? Rice, dal, chapati? Are you dal? No. Are you chapati? No. Are you rice? No. But when you eat that rice, when you eat that dal, some of that dal and rice become the part of your body. Is it not? So dal become you? Potato become you? Right? When you pass stool and urine and the sweat is going, many parts are going out. So you are going out. You understand? You say your body. But your body is not, you know, fixed. It's constantly changing. Something becoming your body and something going out of your body. Medical science says every 7 years, all the chemical constituents of your body is renewed. It's renewed every 7 years. Everything. Your bones, every constituent is renewed. Then which part of the body you say that this is me? Which part of the body you say that this is me? Tell me. You say, I was child.
Now I'm young.
And I become old. If everything changes in your body, which part says that I was child? If medical science says everything changes in 7 years, which is that part which says I was child? When you first came into existence in your mother's womb, you were a single cell. And that single cell become two cells. That two cells become four cells. That four cells become eight cells. And some cells become teeth. Some cells become eyes. And some cells become kidney. Some cells become heart. Right? Is it not? Yes? They have to stop at a certain point. They decide. And you know, some programmed in a way of in a development which never happens in chemistry. Time and space is so important in embryological development. Take your seat. Take your seat, no problem. So, you have to understand what you are. You say your body. Potato is not you. Right? You have to ask this question. If somebody says you are this body, then you say, oh, you are also dal. You are also sabji. Understand? Because you are eating and becoming body. You understand? You have to understand. What is our existence? It's very important. It's very scientific. It's very scientific. We have to study what's our real existence. You know, the scientists, they are studying. Next. You see, about Miller. You know about Miller? Stanley Miller, who did the famous experiment? He produced some, you know, what you can say, basic ingredients of life, right? By taking some, you know, combination of gas and, you know, ammonia and different, you know, things. And he produced nitrogen, he produced the basic ingredients, few amino acids. And then he started claiming that I will produce life in the laboratory. Right? People are very excited at that time. Oh, scientists now can produce life in the laboratory. But his theory is being challenged. You see, what is creating the amino acid, that same thing can destroy the amino acid. Like, you see, there is a spark he used to produce amino acid. And again, that same thing will go into that flask and that amino acid will face the flask and then it will destroy it. So Miller is very intelligent. He collected all these amino acids after that. So scientists now asking the question, in the early earth, if some amino acid will form, suppose it was not life. Amino acid not life. Suppose we accept amino acid form, to become it complex, what protected it from the thunder? Because what is creating it, that can also destroy it. There was no Miller who will collect that into a separate, you know, flask. You understand? You need somebody to collect all these things in a particular place, in a safe manner, which is not true. It is impossible in nature. You understand? So this is one of the challenges. And the thing is that oxygen, he used the reduced atmosphere, right? If oxygen is not present, you know about ozone layer? What it does? It protects from ultraviolet rays, right? If it is not there, oxygen was not there, then this ultraviolet rays will come and it will destroy all the, you know, this, you know, biomolecules. If oxygen is there, Miller type of reactions will not occur. So oxygen is there is problem. Oxygen is not there, there is a problem. So like this, there are many challenges. Next. You see left-handed, right-handed molecules. Life, you know, selects very unique molecules in amino acids, sugar, you know, protein. Some are only left-handed molecules, some are only right-handed molecules. In nature, you find a whole lot of mixture. How only left-handed molecules come together to form such a long chain of, you know, molecules? It's a big challenge, you know. Next. And reducing environment, I already discussed, you know, this technical. I don't want to go into details. Next. RNA world theory was very famous. When RNA, they thought that there was a RNA world, then a protein world, all these things came. So Greek, you know, very famous scientist Greek, what he says. At present, the gap from the primordials of the first RNA system capable of natural selection looks formidably wide. This is a statement of the Greek. And also, Orgel, one of the famous scientists in 1994, he written, the precise events giving rise to RNA world remains unclear. Investigators have proposed many hypotheses, but evidence in favor of each of them is fragmentary at best. The full details of how the RNA world and life emerge may not be revealed in near future. May not be revealed in near future. This is the statement. Next. So, DNA world. You see, also like a chicken and egg problem. Chicken is needed for formation of egg, and egg is needed for chicken. Right? So, which came first? DNA is needed for formation of RNA, RNA is needed for DNA, protein is needed for DNA, DNA is needed for protein. So which came first? Right? You cannot say. Which is the starting molecule? Which is the starting molecule in biology, you cannot say. In an ordinary reaction, you can say, okay, this started from this and then it went like this and like this. In biology, it's not like that. It's like a circular. What is, you know, created, that is also creative. What is created, that is also creative. So you cannot give a linear logic there, right? Can you say which came first? DNA came first or protein came first? No scientist can say. No biologist can say. This is a big dilemma. Next. Okay, this big scientist, you know, David Deamer, you know, he wanted to show to the scientists that how much foolish they are. And he did an experiment. And what are the necessary, you know, what I can say, chemicals are needed for formation of the cell. He took all these chemicals and in a bowl, he put all those chemicals, okay? And waited for a long time to see, let me see first cell forms or not. The cell forms or not. He waited for a long time and answer is no. And it is published in Nature. In the world's famous magazine Nature published this photo. I'm taking it from Nature. And he did dig a hole and put all the chemicals in that and waited for a long time. Let me see if the cell forms or not. And the answer is no. So this is the thing. Also our, you know, director, my Guru Maharaj, the Rokshav Damodar Maharaj, he met also Professor Miller. He was, you know, very excited, was giving, you know, many lectures, and he was saying, I will produce life in the laboratory. And after the lecture, our Guru Maharaj raised the hands. Professor Miller, I have a question for you. What is the question? He said, you are worried about producing all these biomolecules. You produce all the biomolecules and then you form the first life. I will give you ready-made biomolecules. Can you make a life from that? If I give you ready-made, all the biomolecules are there in the living cell. If I provide you, can you produce a living cell? So that I don't know. This was the answer. He was saying, give me money for the project so that I can produce all these biomolecules. But if you are being supplied all these biomolecules, you cannot produce life. Then what about your claim? Our recent director, Srimad Bhakti Madhav Purimal, also told, in living cell, you just puncture it by a needle, and all the essential chemicals will come out, and you wait for millions of years. Will that living cell, that dead cell will be alive again? It's possible. All the essential elements are there in that, but still it will not be alive. You see, a machine is there, this projector is there. All the elements are there, but still it is not a projector. If you give in a bag, all the elements of this I give in a bag. This is projector. Really it will work like a projector? What you need? You need to combine it in a particular manner to work as a projector. And millions of such arrangements are there in the cell. Millions of mechanisms, such mechanisms. How it is possible without the help of a pre-designed, that such a thing can occur. This is a foolish idea. If somebody says, one big tornado came and junkyard, all the essential elements are there and big airplane came into existence. Will you believe it? Big tornado came and all the elements were there and all of a sudden big airplane and standing there. It's foolishness. One big scientist argued like that. How it is possible? How nature can produce an airplane from the junkyard and tornado? Is it possible? Impossible. This was the argument of a big scientist. Next. So I want to give you a hint how the modern science is deceiving. You know, you are not able to understand the theory you are so proud of are not applicable on living system. The theory of physics and chemistry are not applicable on the living system. You accept it or not? Yes or no? Yes? Can you give an example? Can you give an example? Yes, anybody raise your hand who want to give an example that laws of physics and chemistry are not applicable on living system? Yes, please. You see, I given a photo, there is a satellite and there is a door. And you apply Newton's law, projectile motion, right? And ISRO can calculate, right? You see the television, nicely, you know, the satellite is moving. 5 minutes where it will be, 6 minutes where it will be. You can apply projectile motion and you can calculate, right? You can calculate from the laws of mechanics, where it will be, x coordinate, y coordinate, z coordinate, where it will be. But if I release a door, can you calculate where it will go after 5 minutes? Yes or no? Why? Who can say why you cannot calculate where the door will be after 5 minutes? Yes, who wants to say? Yes, please. You cannot control them. Why? What door has extra which a satellite don't have? It has a? But what it has extra in living thing? It has a? Mind. Yes, mind. Very, very interesting. For science students, study about mind. I will ask you, what is the color of mind? You say there is mind, show me mind. I am a scientist. I will ask, show me God. Show me mind. Show me mind. Where it is? What is its color? How it tastes? You know? Can you smell mind? Can you touch it? But I don't believe in mind. I am a scientist after all. I want to see everything. Yes? You say you are saying that I have mind, but scientists will ask, show me mind. You are saying, show me God, show me soul, show me mind. Show me thinking. You are thinking? Yes? Can you show your thinking to me? Yes? You are sitting on a chair, thinking about, you know, different things. Right? So many activities are going on inside. So many activities are going on inside. Can you show all those activities? Like a negative and positive. You know, there is photo, negative and positive. Something is going on inside and going on outside. Both are related. We are not studying all these things. We are not studying at all life. Because this bird has free will. This bird has free will. It can decide where it will go. Left side or right side, sit on antenna, whatever it may be, it can decide. So such a deciding principle is there. It has free will. Ichha Shakti. We call it Ichha Shakti, right? Free will. It has Ichha Shakti, it has free will. And you cannot have any law for that. Thinking, feeling and willing, these are the units of life and you don't have any law for it. Do you have any law in physics and chemistry for thinking, feeling and willing? No. You see the egg. The egg starts with a homogeneous liquid and it liquids precisely. No. Some of it becomes air, you know, eye, kidney and different parts. How a chemical reaction can produce all these things? Different parts. How a mere chemical produce? Don't stop. So all this, you know, liquid, how it can produce, you know, different parts. It's quite surprising. You see the second one, marble and tortoise. Newton's first law, what it says? First law of motion, can anybody say? Newton's first law of motion? Yes, one person raise your hand who wants to say. Newton's first law of motion. Yes, please, tell me. Okay, the object in rest remain in rest, object in motion remain in motion until and unless there is some external force. Okay, take the example of this, marble and tortoise, both are in rest, right? And no external force is acting on both. Marble will not move, but tortoise will decide, I want to move. And it starts moving, and no law can predict when it will move, right? Do you agree with that? None of the living beings follow, don't care the big laws of science. They don't care. Even a bacteria don't care. You cannot predict the motion of a bacteria, where it will go, what it will do. You cannot predict. You understand? This is the important principle we all must understand. Life violates the law of physics and chemistry. This is the distinction between life and non-life. You cannot reduce non-life to life or life to non-life. Impossible. Only life can produce non-life. You understand? But you cannot reduce a non-life system or produce a non-life system to living system. It is impossible. That is the main thing. Next. Okay. Next. Okay. Now scientists, they study bacteria, you know. One article published, the title is, bacteria is small, but not stupid. Bacteria is small but not stupid. Bacteria, you see, Darwin told that living beings are competing, right? They are competing, but they found bacteria cooperating. They are cooperating. They are not only competing, but they are cooperating. If there is, you know, little food is there, comparing to the colony, the number it has, it will cooperate. And, you know, in a way they eat, so that everybody will be fed, right? If there is a lot of food in there, and they will expand and, you know, they attack in different way. You understand? And some bacteria, they sacrifice for the interest of the colony. They learn from the mistakes. Amazing world they discovered from the bacteria. And they say, bacterial intelligence proves that even bacteria is intelligent. Previously following the, you know, Christianity faith, all were thinking only human is conscious. Previously scientists were thinking, oh, only human is conscious. Now they found out even the small bacteria is conscious. Even the small bacteria is conscious, they found even plant is conscious. You know about Bose, Indian scientist, great scientist, he proved even plant is conscious. Now they found all the insignificant living entities, monkey and all, they are all conscious. You cannot avoid the consciousness when you touch biology. Biological systems are sentient systems, they are called. You know, systems biology, now it's becoming a big topic in biology, systems biology. So you cannot separate all the parts and study it. You have to study it as a whole, as a system. So it's a big, you know, science which is developing. And you all must take an interest to know yourself. If you don't know yourself, you cannot do any good to yourself. Like that our, you know, friend told, I am this body and you are only doing good to this body. Using good soap, right? Taking good food, right? And collecting so much of bank balance and doing so many things for this body. And Aadmi chala gaya. And say, you Aadmi chala gaya. But his eye is there, his ear is there, his hair is there. What is left?
Huh?
But you don't study about soul in your studies. You only study about body and bodily benefit. Is there any department which is teaching about what is the benefit of the soul? What is the wealth of the soul? Is there any department which is teaching about that? Then how can you do good to yourself or to others? You are considering others also as chemicals. You know, this environmental pollution. People are producing this environmental pollution, right? Without caring anything, because they are considering everything as chemicals. Everything as chemicals. So you have to be conscious how the things are working, who you are, what is the nature of the soul. That's why. Next. Yes. Atma and soul is a big topic, and all the religion talk about this. All the religion, they talk about this. You can say about Muslimism, you can talk about Christianity, you can say about Vedic religion. Every system talks about this. Atma is the most important fundamental system, and it talks about how to do benefit to that soul, not to this body. Body will be destroyed today or tomorrow. You know about Alexander the Great? When he went to his country and he asked the biggest doctors around him, please come. And he asked them and told, when I will die, put my naked body on the stretcher and keep my two empty hands towards the sky, and you big doctors carry me into this slum area where the poor people are living. And then the doctors told, you are a big man, why we shall do like this with you? Because everybody must know, I only collected garbage, nothing will go with me. I have not collected anything for myself. I only collected garbage. That realization Alexander had. And still we are not awake. Such a big man collected so much of money and fame. He is saying this. I only collected garbage. So try to understand what you are. Don't consider yourself as body. Otherwise you have to think I am dal, I am something, you know. So you have to think you are Atma and then what is the real benefit for the Atma, you have to understand properly. That in our systems, every religious text, they talks about that. Next. We have one book called Subjective Evolution of Consciousness. Can you show me that book? The book written by our founder Acharya Srila Bhaktirakshak Sridhar Maharaj, Subjective Evolution of Consciousness, means never a amoeba become a fish or a frog or a human, but the soul, when the consciousness changes, it can enter from one body to another body after the death. Like every 7 years you are changing your body, the reincarnation is occurring. You can see it in nascent form. Even in this lifetime, at every 7 years, whole body is changing, medical science. That means you are entering into new body. Similarly, at the time of death, your soul enters into new body, according to your consciousness. So, evolution is not taking in the bodily level, it's taking at the level of consciousness. What consciousness? You leaving your body, that type of body you will attain. And there is evolution in the level of consciousness. We are not against evolution, but we are against the objective evolution, which is wrong. Body never changes into one species to another species. Rather, soul enters from one species to another species according to upgradation or degradation, depending on its upgradation or degradation of the consciousness. So what is the perfection of consciousness? What is our highest destiny? How one evolves to that highest destiny? How one degrades also to lower plane of life? All these things are explained in detail in this book. And you must read it and understand what you are. Are you an atom or you are the finest atom of consciousness? You have to understand from this book. Very nice book. And next, can you go to next? Next. We are not the only institute. Many institutes they are working now and around the world on harmony of science and religion. Next. This is a book by one famous scientist you can find in Google. Evolution, a view from 21st century. James S. Shapiro. You know, this is very nice. E-copy is available in Pushpak. And you read this book. This book may be costly for you to purchase, but e-copy is available. Sometime it is freely available. You can see, go through what the recent biology talking about ourselves. Evolution, a view from 21st century. And it will open your eyes and you can confidently practice the religious ideas. Don't ignore the religious idea because it can save yourself. This is the science of the self. You are studying about yourself. You want to study iron, you want to study about stars, you want to study about moon, you are studying about earth, you are studying about so many things. Why not to study about ourselves? When the subject becomes the object of its own study, then spiritual life begins. When the subject becomes the object of its own study, then spiritual life begins. Try to study about yourself scientifically. Then you will be a genuine student. Yes? This is our institute, Sri Chaitanya Saraswati Math in Navadvip. You are most welcome to visit anytime and spend. Many students are there, many doctors, engineers. They are doing this type of study and helping others. We have 150 centers worldwide. In Germany, Japan, Turkey, many places we have centers. And we are teaching everybody about this most important science, science of the self. You are most welcome to contact us. This is my contact details, my email is there, my number is there. This is our address where we update all these videos of our programs. You can see that. Okay, keep it like that. Yes. So if you have any questions, you can ask or comments. Yes.
Okay.
Okay, I will explain later. You have any questions? Any comments? Did you understood what we presented today? Yes? You never say that we are the body. Can you explain others? We are not this body. Can you explain? Can you challenge if somebody teaches you that you are the body, you are the chemicals? Can you challenge this idea? Yes? How many can you challenge? Raise your hands. I am not the body, I am the soul. How many of you can say like that and challenge? And raise your hand. From our lecture, you got some idea. You cannot challenge that we are not this body, we are not the chemicals. Yes? Raise your hands. Yes, sir. Please. Can you say a few words how we are not this body, we are the soul? Okay, sir. Yes. Body is constantly changing. Body is constantly changing and?
And which never changes in this
world. Never changes. In material plane. Yes. Never changes. Very interesting. Your professor is given very nice. So you all must understand and challenge this idea. We are not this body, we are the soul. This is the main teaching. Life can only come from? Life can only come from life. And matter also comes from life. You are there, your leg is growing, your hair is growing. So many living things are producing so many chemicals of their own. Right? Life and matter both are coming from life. If you can understand this much, you understood our lecture. Thank you very much.
Very opportunate activity is going on. there must be some signs behind it. It cannot be a random event that is going on here. So therefore, but then it is so complex that scientists are hard pressed to find the logic of life. So today actually it is information age. That's why you know they have taken up that idea. And previous to this it was a mechanical age, isn't it? Industrial age. And because it was industrial age, there was one scientist, Shapiro, James Shapiro, and inspired by the work of Barbara Macklin, who got the Nobel Prize for what she discovered was jumping genes. He has suggested that now the information age is such that it is influencing the mind of the scientists to think that life will be an informative paradigm. So do you know what is information? You are all full of
instrumentation.
Okay, I think it is more of computer science. But information simply means it's a possibility. Suppose it's a set of all possibilities, then what is the probability that one of those events will occur? So it's a probability in expression and that is information. But knowledge, what is knowledge? Knowledge is something which we know as human beings, as sentient beings. I know something, you know something. How we interpret things, that is the next level. And then life, that is an expression that we are addressing. As it pertains to modern science, in biology, in modern science. Next. So I think I have explained to you in a very simple way that actually information, life, and knowledge, the distinction is meaning. Let's go.
Next.
So you see, this is a picture, and it's like somebody is thinking, and how that thought can be explained in terms of information, isn't it? Information means, suppose we have DNA, RNA, neurons, then how do we come to thinking or knowledge part from the basic level of information that we have in modern science? So this is the question. And unfortunately, even though the mathematicians and scientists wanted to get a mathematical definition of what is thought, but it has proven impossible. Yes. So this is one slide. When we have many people together, suppose we have a group of people, then what is my thought? If I have to convey to you, then I use some language, isn't it? So sometimes language is a symbolic expression, that's why I say. A symbol. But to understand that symbol, I must have some idea of the rules of that language, and you also must have the same idea of the rules of those languages. So when there is a common understanding of the rules, then only the meaning is transferred. So therefore it requires a higher level of perception beyond mathematics. Like, actually mathematics is also a language. That is a higher level of understanding. But I think we put that. So you know, in the companies, they have a lot of manuals, a lot of even computer science codes, so many things are there, but they invest a lot of money in training their own personnel because they want to make clear what they mean by those instructions. So it is not sufficient to give some mathematical formulas or laws or equations to explain the truth. You have to actually explain what company wants from you and what you are supposed to do. So this is a meaning that has to convey from the higher to the one person to the next. Yes. So here is a picture. Suppose there is a bidding event. Bidding means you want to sell something. Then there is the origin of that. Somebody is selling something and somebody is buying that. Okay? And even there is a agent is bidding that. So therefore, even though you are supplying some documents, but those documents are not exactly meaningful unless you convey your thoughts about what exactly you are wanting from those activities. So human life or living activities have a higher level of logic than merely computer science or information paradigm. So from there we come to the question of life. So here is one scientist. you know, Schrodinger, you know, have you heard the name? Schrodinger, Heisenberg, Max Planck, have you heard the names? You didn't hear Max Planck's? Max Planck's? Max Planck? Planck's constant? So at that time there were many scientists, 1940s, 30s, big group of scientists, and they were discussing problems of physics. Now here, Schrodinger, at that time, he thought about this question of thermodynamics and raised this question. And he said, what is this life? It is a book he wrote, what is life? And how is living in a substance continues as a, you know, conglomerate of very well-structured organisms. But actually, to maintain that kind of structure, we have to spend some energy from energy. So how then physically to move being formed? This question he raised. Yes. So you see, life requires cognition at all levels. This is the question of Shapiro. Cognition means is a knowledge paradigm. Like this, you see there is a plant here and the plant is rising against the sunlight. So therefore, the plant, every tissue and everything somehow knows that there is sunlight and it cannot be explained merely as a mechanical phenomenon. Means mechanical logic is not able to explain the plant growth. This is one simple thing right now. And I want to discuss two very simple examples. One is the E. coli. E. coli is a very common, you know, bacteria, actually prokaryote, which has been used all over the you know, biological world to do experiments. So a lot of data is there available on E. coli. The other is the proofreading DNA replication. Something we'll discuss about. And we'll see that how these are all cognitive processes. Mechanical logic is not sufficient to explain them. So you know Monod, Charles Monod, he was in France. He was in France and he was doing a lot of experiments. And at that time, he took large samples of this bacteria and he found there are two sugars. One is a high rate sugar and another low rate sugar, glucose and lactose. So he found that this bacteria, E. coli needs these sugars for its growth and metabolism. So when there is he found that the growth happens in three phases, rapid growth phase, pause and slow growth phase. This is what he observed. That means, suppose if you mix some nutrients, means your glucose and lactose together, and you give it to the bacteria E. coli, then he found that actually he found that this growth rate of glucose is fast, and the growth rate of lactose is very slow. But if you mix these two, then what happens? Then he saw that there is a very fast growth rate in the beginning. Then after some time, there is some pause. And then again, the metabolism continues, but at a very slow rate. So what it means is that somehow the bacteria knows what is in, you know, what is there in the nutrients. It is not simply chemical reaction going on. Because if it was a chemical reaction, it would go according to the law of chemical activities. Do you know what is chemical activity? You are all instrumentation students. I was a chemical engineer and we had this, you know, sometimes we had a subject also control theory. In that we studied all these things with respect to, you know, instrumentation as such. But here actually what happens, what it means is that if it was just a chemical reaction, then this choosing of sugars will not take place. Rather, things will react according to their specific chemical activities. So by chemical reactions alone, we cannot explain this type of sugar digestion within the E. coli. So therefore, this is an example of a higher logic than simply chemical physical. So that means somehow the E. coli knows that I need this sugar. And then, so this is the conclusion that the control of bacterial sugar better happens by choice, E. coli will be glucose and lactose. But why should, you know, chemicals choose, isn't it? Chemicals should just react by there are no physical and chemical laws. Yes, yes. And the very interesting, you know, actually why this is this slide we have presented. Because the question is, what is the logic of life? What is the most fundamental expression of life upon which all life depends? This is the question, isn't it? So what is the modern science answer for that? Or attempt was, what was the secret of life according to Francis Crick, do you know? It was the DNA, isn't it? They say it is in my genes. By this they mean genes have all the necessary information necessary for the life processes. That was the assumption. In other words, they thought the most fundamental unit of life was a material element called gene, which in this case was DNA. And why they were so excited about it was, during the cell replication process, the DNA is sexually transformed. I cannot speak loudly, it is beyond my capacity. Please try to hear as far as possible, come forward, but it is beyond my capacity to speak, beyond what I am doing, shouting. Anyway, so the thing is, the DNA molecule is during replication process, the cell divides into two. So therefore, the parent DNA molecule divides into, actually separates. And then it is copied by the cellular mechanism and it becomes a two. So therefore one cell becomes two cells. Each has one of the parent's DNA strand from which it acts as a template to copy another, to manufacture another DNA strand, isn't it? So during that copying process, there is possibility of errors coming in, isn't it? Suppose there is some strand like this and I am making another strand. In that process, manufacturing process, possibility of some mistakes are there. Then how does a cell ensure that mistakes don't occur? So if you study that very carefully, Shapiro says this is a cognitive process. How he concludes that very simple process. So there is a two-stage process in this. First is the polymerization stage, because it is making a big polymer, DNA polymer is making. And second stage is mismatch. If it sees some mismatch, it must repair. So actually the correction occurs in both the stages. In the polymerization stage itself, when it is forming a big chain, there is a correction mechanism. And when a chain actually has been made, then again it checks. So there is a double two-stage process, at least in the prokaryotes. But in eukaryotes or higher animals, it is much more complex, but logically similar what is being shown here. So in the first stage, polymerization itself, you see there are various things, detecting distortion, removal of the brain, relieving of it. And means if it checks that in the polymerization process, if some error has come, it will stop the polymerization process. Then after stopping that, it will correct it. And then when it is corrected, again it will start the polymerization process. So it is not just a chemical reaction. If it is just a chemical reaction, it should just, you know, become big, you know, some kind of molecule. Why it should do any eruption? But here is an eruption. It is a cognitive process. And second step is, if you see there is a mismatch repair, second step that we have seen, means once the strand has been made, then what it does is, there is a post-replication proofreading. So here we see three types of enzymes, mutase. This is a little difficult, you know, terminology for you. But what I am talking is a very simple thing. I am talking about the logic. Don't get confused by the, you know, the names here. But try to understand this example and try to read about this when you go back to your homes or your hostels. And try to, you know, get what I am trying to say. Now, so there is mutase, and mutase. Three types of enzymes are there. These are enzymatic processes. So mutase, what mutase does is, first it scans whether the strand has been made correctly or not. After the scanning process, the mutant will go and fix itself with that particular site. And after fixing it, it will fix the mutage. Mutage will cleave that portion, and then they will do a repair and insert it correctly. anyhow, it will correct the mistake. There are at least two or three stage process like this. So the question is this, the point that Shapiro is telling that these are allostatic effects. Now, in your in your instrumentation sciences, the feedback control and feed forward control, all this is your study. Now, in the control mechanism, you know elaborate mechanism has been set to get an effect at a particular point. That means, suppose if I want a particular node, so that a particular flow rate I should achieve, then by a lot of mechanism, you actually calculate the set point. And you calculate the load necessary, calculate the force necessary. So much things you do, which is not exactly a mechanical process solely, because there is a algorithm involved here. Isn't it? A feedback control, feed forward control, all the algorithms. So actually we see that somehow in the biological systems, apart from the physical processes are utilized according to the algorithm. So how come in a chemical world, in the physical world, an algorithm is being operated? Understand this question. So apart from physics and chemistry, we have to deal with algorithms. Now anyway, I have lost the continuity of this presentation. Briefly I will say that actually this comes to the law of causality. How things are being caused, isn't it? Modern science took a materialistic approach to explain what is causality. So that therefore we have to place it along with this ancient idea which was given by Aristotle and compare it with the modern ideas. What was the modern science direction that it took? So you know what is the elements of causality? What is cause and effect? You know what is cause and effect? Modern science is based upon cause and effect, forces. There is matter, there is forces, there are fields. All this cause a particular type of phenomena, isn't it? Like suppose every day the sun is rising. So what causes that? It's a natural question, isn't it? The sun rises every day, and when the sun sets, the moon rises. We can see the moon in the sky. So we have a question comes: how all this is happening? Similarly, causality is not only in the non-living world, but there is also causality in the biological world, the living world. So we have a question. So therefore, there Aristotle discussed there are four elements of causality. What he called material cause, then efficient cause, formal cause, and the final cause. Modern science takes only the efficient cause and the material cause. And it does not accept as scientific the formal cause as well as the final cause. So one simple example, Aristotle argued like this. Let's suppose we have this big wall is there. And for our example, let's say a China wall is there, the Great Wall of China. If somebody asks, what is the cause behind the Great Wall of China? Then according to modern science, we can only say there are some bricks. Are you able to understand? Okay, one of you tell them, how did that big wall of China come according to modern science? What will be the explanation? Can you answer? Try to think about this. So modern science will say that there are some raw material, means bricks of different sizes, some are heavier, some are lighter, and the design principle will be how to arrange them in a particular design. Then we have a wall, isn't it? But Aristotle said that is not sufficient, because that does not explain why the wall was there, at all. That means if you have to ask why the Great Wall of China is there, then you have to ask what was its purpose. The Great Wall of China was made to protect the country from the Mongols, isn't it? So, but does it come out from science? Does this come out from science as it is understood today? Yes or no? So the purpose, meaning and purpose don't come out from the physics and chemistry and mathematics, isn't it? So So here is the whole dilemma. That's why my article was named Information, Knowledge and Life in 21st Century. It is being realized that we have, I mean, because it is the information world, if you study advanced biology, theoretical biology, they will say, oh, this is the informatic paradigm. But it is not, actually it is not just informatic paradigm, it is a knowledge paradigm. Living organism somehow knows, the cell somehow knows what kind of DNA it should have. It can rearrange, it can proofread, it can, you know, restructure. This is a big, you know, chapter of modern science already, at least as far as the experimental biology is concerned. But what is the theory behind all this? Where is the theory that explains that we observe in biology? And that's what we don't have. You know, nature and all these deep scientists telling, we have no theory of the biology. We have no theory in biology. But without a theory, can you say something is complete science? Means you have some observation, but you have no explanation for it. Then what kind of science you are talking about? Isn't it? Okay, so I would like to, you know, conclude by telling one more thing, one more important point here. Life is a knowing paradigm, knowledge paradigm, isn't it? Knowledge means knower, knowing and known. So, and science is about studying. We want to know the truth, isn't it? That's why we are doing science. So then, when we talk like that, then who is the person who is studying the science? All this, you know, sun, moon, earth, or even himself. Who is studying that? That is a person, isn't it? That's a person. But does atoms and molecules have personality? Doesn't have personality. But how do we have personality? And not only personality, personality means individuality as well as particularity. How do we have? Actually, in inorganic world also, these three are everywhere. Like, suppose you say the fruit. Fruit is a universal. Like, the guava is also a fruit. Apple is also a fruit. The banana is also a fruit. All are fruit. I can say all of them, it's a universal. It applies to all fruit family. Now, if I say apple, then it is a particular fruit. Apple is a very particular fruit. And the apple that I take and I'm eating is the individual fruit of that family. Individual apple. But in case of, you know, living organisms, that individuality is very easy intrinsic. It's very, very, you know, what to say, not explainable by, you know, because we can only converse in universal language in modern science. We cannot say that something has meaning for you and something has different meaning for another person in science. That's why they take so much effort. But living organisms means the uniqueness or individuality is very intrinsic part of the reality. So therefore, we say there are two things, subject and object. What is we are studying is the object of our study. But who is studying that? That is the person, or the scientist, or the student, and he is the subject. So, for an object like this, where is the subject of this? Means who is studying that? Means it is external to this. Isn't it? But if I study life, then who is studying this life? I myself am studying this life. So it is intrinsic, internal principle. It's a deeper principle. Therefore, life is superior to matter. This is the very conclusion, Vedanta conclusion. Life is superior to matter. And matter is inferior to life. What is matter? Matter is the knowledge of the living person. Or is self-externality. Anyway, so therefore, modern science idea of life coming from matter is a misleading idea. And there is no experimental or scientific proof for that. But science means we go by evidence. So the evidence is that all living forms come from pre-existing living forms. Isn't it? Human beings come from previously existing human beings. Animals come from previously existing animal forms. And all these living organisms produce so much chemicals that biosphere cannot maintain without living organisms. So therefore we see the diversity of life everywhere. Then how come we make this conclusion without any proof actually that life somehow comes as a combination of organisms? So life is both the mind as well as the body simultaneously. Means that means thinking, feeling and willing. These are the symptoms of life. And one of the main symptoms I was discussing with my spiritual master yesterday, that Aristotle so told in De Anima that the symptom that plants are alive is that they have local sensing and movement. But he said, but actually the main symptom is that they are dying. When the plant dies, animal dies, the cell dies, when cell death occurs, we don't see that type of movement, we don't see that type of local sensing. But how come, that type of loving exists while the living being is alive? The symptom of life is intelligence is there. Like Stenhouse says, intelligence is the variable adaptability while the living being is alive. So when it is alive, we see a different type of symptoms. But when there is death, we don't see the symptoms anywhere. That's what we are going everywhere and trying to, because already this is coming in modern science, the big, lot of literature is there in modern science, polemic literature means people are fighting about this. They are not agreeing, they are not able to come to any conclusion about what is the origin of life. Means whether life was first or matter was first. So evidence says that life comes from life. And also evidence says life produces all kinds of matter. Then it will be much interesting except that originally it is life. Life is much more complex, much more dynamic. And so what is the, why we take this unscientific principle that somehow life could have come from material combinations? That's where the modern science is making the mistake, and somehow they can come up and scientifically study themselves what is already happening in modern biology, and then they can cooperate with other fields like religion. Not only one religion, all religions can take up. And they come together and come to some proper dialogue, then it can be good to ourselves and to everyone. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Any questions? So please take interest in this topic. When you grow up, you are just young men. But when you grow up, then you can study something in this line and you can write articles, you can come to some of our conferences, you can come to our centers. In this way, you can be impressed. It will be nice.
Who wants me to talk for 5 minutes? 5 minutes? Okay, everything is finished anyway. Let me see 5 minutes. 5 minutes we cannot complete the idea, but ॐ अग्निनाथ मीरांगस्य ज्ञानञ्जना सुमकया चक्षुरु मिलितं येन तस्मा श्री गुरुवे नमः गुरुवभीष्ट सुकृतानुगणैर सुस्तं चिन्त्य चिन्त्य समास्तवेदनि पुनः सिद्धोपान्तरङ्गं गोविन्दमीरगुलाम्परं सुन्दरं प्रदिशं गुरुक्षात्रं मोहिविया. Well, we just got to the end. Everybody can feel peace, almost 2 hours. And I would like to thank all of you for inviting us to come. And I don't want to give another lecture. Scientist lecture and technical things. I just wanted to go to the point where they want to come and where they already have come. The difference between the body and the soul. The difference between matter and spirit. Which is this. I want to ask all of you, how many of you knows about Bhagavad Gita? Mostly everybody, no? Huh? Everybody raise your hand. Who knows the Gita? No No, really professional reading.
He reads yes. Gita every day.
This Gita, Gita.
Yes.
Gita is the science of self-realization. And whatever we have told you is in the Gita. Gita is everything. Everything is there. Science, philosophy, yoga, everything. And the difference between body and soul is saying Gita. The Hinos mean Yata, the Heta, Moran, the Mala, Yara, Tata, the Haram, Taras, Prati, Viras, Takshan, Mim. They already explained it in a very scientific way. How the soul passed from the childhood to the boyhood and to the old age and death. But the one who is within the body, which is the soul, never changed. Body changed, but the soul never changed. And this is what we want to present to you. The science of self-realization, which is in Gita, in all of this book. Gita, La Gita, we don't want to sell you this book. We want to present this nice book for you all. You know, nutrition, nourishment. And we will ask you for a donation, for printing cost. Printing cost? And Maharaj already presented very nice this subject, evolution of consciousness. And we have the Hong Kong folk, which is talk about Chintamani. How do you feel when you get home? Very nice. First thing, when you go home, you want to release from your juice. Chapat, out. You want to have some place to sit, TV on, and some popcorn, like that, or some chapatis, like that. This book is speaking about how do you feel it in your real home, which is the home of God. We all belong to that place. Tadama Paramam Baba, Krishna say that this is my real abode. And whatever is saying Gita is to prepare us to go back home, back to Godhead. Whatever science is in the world is to teach you. Nobody wants to be ignorant. Why? Because we're full of knowledge. Nobody wants to die. Because we're by nature, we are eternal. The soul is eternal. Antaman, antamanta, idme, deha, nitya sota, sarinima. The soul is always, you know, Ayo nitya sasato jam purano. Ahanjate nahanjamane sarire. Bodies die, but the soul always continues. The body is changed, but soul is eternal. Soul is a particle of God. And it's jiva, mahamavanso, jiva loka, jiva bhuta, sanatana. It's eternal, and eternal occupied in Sanatan Dharma. All of you know the word Sanatan Dharma. I am from the West, coming from very far, and I'm trying to explain you Hindus what you, by nature, you know. You must know it better than me. And by the grace of my spiritual master, our spiritual master, we're traveling all over the world, over India, and going university, places, house, to explain this nice science, the science of God, the science of the soul. That's why this book is are for. This nice book, red book, is Omni Science. It's made by Santa Maharaj, imagine.
Yeah?
One of our compiled.
One of our friend made from our
And we have this very beautiful Hindi book. It's called Premadama Deva Stotra, which is the life and soul, where we want to get you. The point that we want to connect you is, you already know, many of you know about Krishna, Bhagavan. All of you, because you're born here, and by home, tradition, you know about Krishna. Who is Krishna? Who is Krishna? The Lord. How he looks like. You don't know? Who knows how Krishna looks like? How he looks like? You see him everywhere, all the Dukani, all the stores have pictures of Krishna. All houses. Huh? Krishna is like blue, blackish, Shyama Sundara, the most beautiful black boy, Shyama Sundara. And from home you must know about this. And this book is about how Krishna appeared 500,000 years ago in West Bengal, where we're coming from. We're coming so far from West Bengal to Bombay to try to talk to you and be friendly, friendly talks. And try to present how is the life, Leela, and pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Krishna himself, who appeared 500 years ago in West Bengal, Navadvipa, where the mailing center is. And you saw in the picture, in the photos. This is the meaning of this book. Okay. And we would like to, if you have any question, any simple question, you can ask us and we try to answer you, and we will give you our address and the journey home.
And distribute them.
Yes, distribute it to all of you.
Give them more. Give them more.
Huh? Yeah.
Give them more.
Yes, wait, wait, wait. Then here, then there. No, no, there's no. There's not a thing done. I will pass.
Oh, that's it, that's it.
And whoever wants to get a book, he can give a contribution on our preaching program, our expenses, preaching program. Cheap, cheap. 5 rupees, 10 rupees. The most expensive is Gita, which is 100 rupees. Please.